That little misdirection. They still got some work to do in the West, but the East race, well, that could come to an end today in Gainesville. On a steamy Saturday here in the Swamp, the Gators can quench their thirst for a division title with a win over Vandy. You're watching College Football presented by Cars.com. The Gators have won 23 of the last 24 meetings, but that Vandy win was here 2 years ago. Their only win in the Swamp since 1945. Kick is away from Tommy Openshaw. And on the return, Brandon Powell gets some nice blocks. He's out across the 45, stays on his feet across midfield, and hauled down inside the 25-yard line. That'll set up the Gators nicely. 72 yards on the return. Beck Mullins along with Anthony Beck, the 12-year NFL veteran. Just the kind of start the Gators were looking for, Anthony, on a day where they can take a big step closer to their first SEC crown since their national championship team won the league back in 2008.
Well, you're right, and head coach Jim McElwain has not been shy about the opportunity and the task at hand. He's really galvanized these players. He's gotten the young guys and the older guys to come together, and that's been a big part of this team playing better this season.
For the Gators, while the rest of the SEC East sort of crumbled around them, they have taken advantage and jumped out to the 7-1 record. And breaking a tackle down the sideline is Jordan Scarlett as his helmet gets popped off in the hit, but he's inside the five. And it's a first and goal for Florida after the 20-yard run.
Jordan Scarlett is a part of a package with number 21, Kelvin Taylor. And he's a big back, big run last week in the fourth quarter against Georgia. Heck of a start for this young man, getting more carries in this McElwain offense.
Treon Harris running the show at quarterback, the sophomore out of Miami making his 10th career start today, including his third in a row since the suspension of Will Grier prior to the LSU game. Harris will flip it to Kelvin Taylor on the cutback, and he ran right into Zach Cunningham, one of the stars of that Vandy defense. Well, Treon Harris, he may not be the most accurate of passers, Anthony, just over 50%, but what Vandy has to respect are those improv skills.
You're right. His legs are a huge part of what this offense has grown without Will Grier at the quarterback position, and zero interceptions. Protecting the football has been the most key facet of this young quarterback's repertoire.
On second and goal. Empty set for Harris with four wides. Looking across the middle, the slant caught in the end zone for a touchdown, Brandon Powell. Deserving, he gets the TD after the nice kick return to set that short scoring drive up.
Runs a quick slant, fast slot receiver. Does he hold on to the football? Again, there's a fight between him and the Vanderbilt defensive back, Williamson. The ball looks like it's moving. The question is it in his arms when it's moving? We're going to take a look at this one.
They're going to look for indisputable video evidence to see whether this will stand or if they need to reverse their decision. Yeah.
Again, did the tip of the ball touch the ground? His arm is there. Question is his arm underneath the ball? It's compressed down. It's hard to actually see it from the video. So like you said, it's got to be indisputable to the replay booth's eyes.
You're looking for complete and continuous control of the ball throughout the process of contacting the ground. Touching the ground does not always mean you've lost control. That's the other thing. As long as you have it secured. If it stays, it will be Powell's fourth touchdown catch of the season. He set it all up with the 72-yard kick return.
And all three phases. Those are the things you haven't seen with Gator football. The offense, the special teams, along with the defense. Again, you see Powell, the quick slant, closely guarded by Williamson. Question is, do they see any part of that ball touching the ground? Again, the ball is definitely moving. There's no question about that. That's pretty close right there.
The call on the field is a touchdown, so they would need the indisputable video evidence to show them that he did not secure the ball.
And you know, Coach Jim McElwain talked about fast starts, talked about this offense getting out quickly, getting some energy, and the special teams with the big return, like you mentioned. Those are the things that get you on the scoreboard quick. And with Vanderbilt, their offense is not built to come back. The way they play a brand of football, they really stress defense. And the last couple weeks, their field has been shortened as far as defending the offenses. And right there, that first series with the big return, this defense is put in the hole again, defending starting in the red zone.
Kind of day where you learn a lot about the focus and the maturity of a team that is new to this situation. Are you going to come out and play as quickly and as strong as you did against your arch rival Georgia last week? Are you going to see that against Vanderbilt, a team that some folks might tend to overlook?
And we talked to a couple players yesterday, and they had mentioned in the past they might have just rolled out there and assumed they were just going to beat on Vanderbilt and it would just happen. And that's the difference, I think, this year. Every game has meant something. Coach McElwain talks about the hows and the whys, and this is one of the reasons they want to come out regardless of who it is.
Referee Brad Rogers.
After review, the rolling on the field is reversed. The ball hit the ground. It was an incomplete pass. It's going to be third down on the 5.5-yard line. Clock operator, please reset the clock to 13 minutes and 24 seconds. 13:24, please. Thank you.
So the touchdown reversed. They'll take it away from Powell, and now it's third down for Florida. Against the strength of this Vanderbilt team, their defensive unit much improved from a year ago.
Yeah, Fred Johnson, true freshman, jumps in at right tackle today. Their right tackle, normally Halter, will move to left with the injury of number 78 left tackle David Sharp.
McGee, the tight end, in motion. Harris on the rollout, throwing to the end zone, and it's busted up, incomplete by Andrew Williamson. And it's fourth down. And one of the more remarkable stories of the week about to unfold. A new kicker for the Florida Gators. A walk-on was expected to come out and handle the kicking duties, but now he's waved back, and it looks like the offense is going to stay out there.
Watched them practice yesterday. They had a lot of goal line, red zone, tight plays. Tight ends, especially number 83, Jake McGee's attached right here to the end of the line. Watch him as they try to get Treon Harris outside the pocket.
And now Vanderbilt will call a timeout. This, by the way, not unusual for Florida. They're 12 of 16 on fourth down
timeout
this year.
Vanderbilt, their first. It's 30 seconds. 30
seconds. Coach McElwain's going to take chances. He understands what's at stake, but he's got to try to energize his team, build the confidence. They got a true freshman at the right tackle. They got a true freshman at the left guard. He wants to get these guys fired up and get that dominance, that attitude that they desperately need on offense.
And perhaps, too, Anthony, the decision a little bit easier because of the uncertainty with their kicking game. Down to Paul Carcaterra.
Beth, you mentioned the open tryout with Neil McInnis emerging. Over 150 at first, whittled down to about 70. He gets a spot on this Gator roster. I watched him in warmups, though. He was a little shaky, spraying the ball all over the field, to be quite honest with you. His kicks sometimes really low, sometimes high, left and right. Consistency a factor, and nerves.
Hasn't kicked in a game since his high school days 4 years ago, Paul. So they will keep the offense out there on fourth and goal. Taylor will give it off to Powell. Harris, the quarterback, trying to lead the way with a block, and he's bounced out of bounds at the three by Torin McGaster. And the defense for Vanderbilt with a big stop.
Torin McGaster makes the tackle for Vanderbilt.
This Vanderbilt defense has been tough all year long. They push this play to the outside. The Gators want to get inside, do a nice job, a contain on the outside. And McKester gets the big tackle to stop Florida on fourth down.
Go for it instead of going to their new kicker, Neil McGinnis, would have been a 22-yarder.
It would have been a chip shot. Would have been a good opportunity to get him involved and get him kind of those reps he needs.
Johnny McQuarrie will hand it off and slam down to the turf inside the one. Is the Gainesville native Ralph Webb, and it was the All-America candidate Jonathan Bullard who was ready and waiting. Well, for the Commodores, 6'4 sophomore Johnny McQuarrie is their guy today. He's got twice as many interceptions as he does touchdowns, and so ball security job number one for him. The turnovers have been lethal for this offense all season.
And he has the ability to run also. He's got to be smart with the football, especially when you're pinned back against a defense that's good as the Florida Gators. You've got to get downs and distances on the early downs on offense. Right now, I'm not doing a good job.
Webb out of the eye. May have gotten a yard wrapped up by Brian Cox Jr., the junior out of Fort Lauderdale. As we take a look at today's impact players brought to you by Jared, and we'll start out with Ralph Webb and his homecoming today.
You got to find ways to get Ralph Webb the ball at least 20 times. Jonathan Bullard, big time run stopper in the SEC, and the cornerback number one, Vernon Hargraves, a potential top 10 pick this draft if he comes out. He is a game breaking cornerback.
Webb again gets the call, and Webb into the second level and out across the 15, and a first down for Vanderbilt.
He's their leading rusher. He's the guy that gets this offense going on a tough third down run, being able to squirt through. Pulley does a nice job, 77, just kind of sealing everything off, and he cuts right behind him, and he gives you that quickness and burst, really a huge conversion pinned back on third down.
Nice get for Webb, coming in averaging 86 yards per game. Little breathing room now for Vandy. And the ball pops loose. Sims couldn't hold on to it, and a loss on the play for the Commodores. How about an update on Notre Dame-Pittsburgh? Adnan?
All right, thank you very much, Beth. It's our Taco Bell studio update as Notre Dame, week after escaping against Temple, it's Deshaun Kizer to Will Fuller. So far, the Fighting Irish looking good against Pitt. It's 7-0. Beth, back to you.
Well, Adnan, we expect that one. Maybe another close one. They've split the last six meetings, all of them decided by a touchdown or less.
And that mishandle right there by Sims is going to cost this football team. Minus 10 yards, second and 20. Not a lot of plays in Andy Ludwig, the offensive coordinator's playbook.
It's back to Webb at tailback. Staying on his feet, driving forward. May have gotten back out to the 14 with his forward progress. Give him 7 yards on that run.
Number six, Darius Sims, also with Webb. These are the two playmakers. These are the guys that got to touch the ball. Number six, Sims, former wide receiver. They moved him in a bye week to the running back. Sometimes they're in there together. They rotate in. They're the quickest players and really the only players that have stepped up for this offense.
Not easy to run on this Florida defense. They've allowed just 6 rushing scores in 8 games. They're ranked 15th in the country in rush D, and it's another third and long. Webb runs right into a guy they call the heart and soul of this defense, Jared Davis, along with his linebacking mate Antonio Morrison. They really drive this engine.
100 tackles last year, came back from major knee surgery, has been the heart and soul. He's the alpha of this team. And he's got tremendous instincts, and he makes plays, and he's always in the right spots right there. Big tackle at the line of scrimmage for this Gator defense.
Tommy Openshaw on to punt. And a dangerous return man in the freshman Antonio Callaway. A 72-yard punt return for a touchdown in the LSU game a couple weeks ago. A chance for Callaway at his own 31. Special teams making plays early for the Gators. They will have terrific field position in Vandy territory at the 42 after a 29-yard return. It was the punter Openshaw who made the tackle.
Never a good thing for Vandy if you got to make tackles from your punter.
It's a hot one today in Gainesville, and big expectations for the Gators and a chance to clinch a spot in the SEC championship game.
In New Roads.
The Shira family Heisman Plaza outside the Swamp. Three pretty big names there with Spurrier, Tebow, and Werfel. They're three Heisman Trophy winners. After a nice punt return from Callaway, Harris off the play fake, looking deep. Incomplete at the 2-yard line. Intended for Chris Thompson, who gets the start today, replacing DeMarcus Robinson. Caleb Azubike was putting some pressure on the quarterback. There's been a lot made, by the way, of the three Heismans, with 11-7-15 being our date today, and also the number that those three guys happen to wear.
That's pretty unique, I would say, for today's football game, and three extraordinary players, extraordinary quarterbacks that really, over the decades, have made this place so valuable.
And an opportunity to clinch the Eastern Division at home for the first time in 15 years. That is the hope of the faithful here. And breaking tackles is DeAndre Goolsby, number 30. Taken out of bounds around the 17-yard line. They've got three decent tight ends, and they like to use them all.
They will, and this is one of their more dynamic players that can get up the field and make players miss. And this is the versatility this offense has, and the tight ends have been in a premier part of this system. You look at their yards and receiving touchdowns, the tops in the SEC, and that's important for Treon Harris, who's a quarterback that if he doesn't find those big receivers down the field, he'll look for the tight end.
Used to be that tight end in motion. They've got two of them in the game right now. Jordan Scarlett with the carry. Gets down inside the 15 as we take a look at today's impact players. Brought to you by Jared. Kelvin Taylor, a couple of touchdowns in the win against Georgia last week.
Big play running back, super speed into the hole. Antonio Callaway, true freshman, has been in a dynamic, explosive receiver. Zach Cunningham, his job today will be to watch Treon Harris. Wherever he goes, Cunningham goes.
I have a player injured right now for Vanderbilt. It's one of their linebackers, Darian Herring, the senior out of Stone Mountain, Georgia. And we will take a timeout. 7:46 to go here in the first. Defending champs number 3 in the first playoff rankings. Both games also streaming live on Watch ESPN. Scoreless first quarter. Florida had a touchdown and then was reversed upon review. They've been set up with good field position, a couple of nice returns on a kick and a punt. And now a third down coming up here after the stop by Andrew Williamson.
Well, they've been trying to get to the perimeter of this defense. And be quite honest with you, number 32, Andrew Williamson, has been stepping up and taking his game over at the safety position, just coming downhill, making big stops. This defense is much improved. The 22nd ranked defense in the country, they're not going to be scared to come up and fight battles with this Gator offense.
He's their leading tackler. Out of Pinson, Alabama, Darian Herring has returned after missing a play with the injury. Third and 6. Harris, heat coming. Gets away from Weatherly, and he'll run with it inside the 5. And he's got a first down, first and goal. With Weatherly giving chase, a 10-yard gain.
This is the added feature that he brings to this offense, his legs. When he sees his first progression, if it's not there, go run. He's getting chased down by Weatherly, number 45, a big outside linebacker, quick enough, fast enough to get up the field and move the chains and get you in first and goal situation.
looking for plays that he's comfortable with from the coaches.
Their jumbo package, you see number 94 defensive player Brian Cox in the game.
They will follow him. There's a nice block on the edge to spring Kelvin Taylor, touchdown. As Cox ran right through Trey Herndon, the defensive back didn't have a chance. Anthony, you wave off the kicker the last time, so go to Cox this time.
Yeah, there's no question. Cox is 270 pounds. It's not a great matchup when it's him against the corner.
And Kelvin Taylor now with his 11th touchdown of the season. And the extra point is no good on the first attempt from their new kicker, the walk-on Neil McGinnis. The score will stay 6-0, Florida.
It's all set up by Treon Harris, the quarterback, moving in the pocket, getting the first down with his legs. And then on the outside, Kelvin Taylor trying to get in the end zone, and Brian Cox, the defensive end number 94, blowing up the corner to get him in the end zone. Welcome back, and this isn't fair, folks, on the outside. And that's a business decision by the cornerback coming up, trying to take on number 94, Brian Cox, at 270 pounds. And he gives the running back some love on that for sure. And, you know, he might want to get a pass once in a while, but he loves knocking out those DBs on the edge. That's why he's out there. He's a great athlete. Played with his dad, Brian Cox, the linebacker from the Jets, Dolphins, Bears.
Those defensive guys love a shot on the offensive side as Austin Harden will kick it away in the direction of Darius Sims, and that will sail over his head now. I don't know. How about an update from Adnan around the SEC?
Beth, I got Georgia on my mind. They're taking on Kentucky on the SEC Network. And this is Terry Godwin, the true freshman here, the scoop and score. His first career touchdown as they take advantage of the sloppiness. 7-0 on the SEC Network. Beth?
Adnan, you got a couple teams there that are really pulling for Vandy today because the Florida Gators can shut down the Eastern race with a win here today and get back to the SEC championship game for the first time since 2009 when they lost to Alabama. And Jim McElwain was on the other side. He was the offensive coordinator for Nick Saban. And now Brian Cox Jr., who we just saw as the fullback on the touchdown run, back out there in his usual role along the D-line. They'll run the jet sweep to Trent Sherfield, and he's got the first down down to Paul.
Well, Vernon Hargraves has earned the reputation nationally as one of the top corners, rightfully so. The player on the other side for the Gators, that's Jalen Tabor, the sophomore. He is not far behind. Tabor told me that he feels like he's one of the top corners on this team, and he looks at a guy like Hargraves as motivation, and he's been a mentor to him.
Well, Paul, so far Vandy has chosen to stay away from those corners. They've been all running plays, Paul.
Competition is fierce between Hargraves and Tabers. Tabor said that when Hargraves sees Tabor get a pass thrown on him in practice, he is livid. And defensive coordinator Jeff Collins told me yesterday, the two feed off each other and are the most competitive group he's ever coached.
And defensive coordinator Jeff Collins said, listen, you know, the DB's playing time is predicated on their practice suite, and it's the most competitive group. And I'll tell you, Tabor's arm length is incredible. You'll see him impress all game long. Very good corner, loves the position, plays it well.
He's sitting this third down out, third and two. Pressure coming, option right, the pitch to Webb. He's got the first down, down to the 45-yard line, wrapped up by Jared Davis. Well, today on ESPN, Big Ten action for you. A couple of unbeatens. Number 9, Iowa, taking on Indiana at 3:30. Presented by Cars.com. Then Michigan State and Nebraska out in Lincoln at 7, presented by Hilton Hotels. Who's in for the college football playoff? The first rankings are out as Josh Crawford runs it and gets roped out of bounds.
We are looking at 10 unbeatens now into Saturday action, but at least five of those, Anthony, will be knocked out in head-to-head matchups before the end of the season.
You're right. It starts with Clemson, obviously, later on today playing Florida State. And these are huge matchups. And you're right. Those teams will start chicken away at each other, and other teams will move up into those spots.
TCU, Oklahoma State, one of them will lose for the first time this afternoon. McCrary out into the flat to Dallas Rivers, the sophomore out of Stone Mountain, Georgia. Pick up a five.
I talked to Derek Mason, the head coach of Vanderbilt, about his offense. He said, listen, we're going to run the ball as many times as possible. We got to keep the ball in safe passing ranges. You see a quick swing pass. You see the nice running plays getting to the edge. You got the jet sweeps. Keeping them ahead of the change, that'll be key.
Rivers gets the call up the middle, wrapped up by Caleb Brantley, and he will not get there. Sophomore out of Crescent City, Florida, sniffed it out.
Talk about field position for this team. I think Vanderbilt, in my opinion, kicks this. If you pin them back, your defense, I think, is playing well. They show that they can play on in the red zone. Why not try to pin this this Gator offense back and make them work?
McCrary will depart, the quarterback out, and the punter does come on. Tommy Openshaw, who handles both the punting and the kicking duties. And it is Vernon Hargraves who is back deep inside his own 10-yard line, shielding his eyes against the sun. That may be an issue on the punt. Hargraves with the fair catch. 22 yards, but he does his job dropping it inside the 20 at least. And with 3:10 to go here in the first, a 6-0 Florida lead. The touchdown run for Kelvin Taylor and then the missed PAT. So it's back to work for Treon Harris. We talked about how they like to give him throws that he's comfortable with. And also, unlike some other quarterbacks, those feet are part of his progressions and his checkdowns.
You're right. When he's in the pocket, he's not capable yet of getting to his progression. So they try to get him on one side where all the receivers are in his vision. And your legs are is absolutely right. They don't want him to go through one to two to three. They want his third option to be his legs. And you've seen that a little earlier in the game today.
Two tight ends with Goolsby and McGee both on the left side. They'll throw it the other way to DeMarcus Robinson. Their leading receiver so far this year in terms of catches. How about Harris?
Throwing at all levels, getting to the outside. You see three receivers in his vision of his eyes, and now when he throws the ball, he has everybody in his view. That's going to be big in this game plan today. Designed runs. This guy can beat you with his legs. Harris is a tremendous runner, like another running back. And then extending plays. You want to force him to the left, but here he makes Georgia pay down the sidelines to his favorite receiver, Callaway, for the big touchdown.
Harris gives to Jordan Scarlett. He'll be taken down behind the line. Let's see where the progress actually gets him out to the 24-yard line. Zach Cunningham wrapped him up. And it appears it will be third and one.
Yeah, and Jordan Scarlett's earned the right to get the ball. And that's really what Coach is saying to us when he talks about competition at the position. The guys that practice hard have earned the reps in games prior. Coming off his best game last week, that big 60-yard run against Georgia and a 96 yards rushing, 10 yards a clip isn't bad.
They'll go to their big package with Ryan Cox and another defender, C.C. Jefferson, looking to help block in front of Taylor, and he's got the first down. And he will get out across the 30-yard line. How about an update from the Carolinas, Adnan?
Thank you very much, Beth. Interviewed Larry Fedora this week. He loves Marquise Williams, and why not? Rushing touchdown here sets a school record for touchdowns responsibility with 80, 21-3 UNC. Beth?
Thank you, Adnan. Well, the winner of that one will control their destiny. The Heels trying to get to that ACC championship game for the first time in school history. They got to be kicking themselves for that South Carolina loss, their only loss to start out the season.
And Duke lagging a bit from their tough loss against Miami.
Blitz coming from Cunningham. It's picked up, and it's dropped off to Robinson. Breaking a tackle out across midfield. Got a nice block from Callaway on the edge. And he's down inside the 35. Williamson ran him out. 36 yards. And a nice play by Harris to spot him across the middle.
They're going to run a blitz inside. And there's nobody home in the middle of the field. And you see him catch the football. Robinson kind of looked around, said, wait, there's nobody home, gets up the sidelines. He's really been a nice playmaker for this team. Was shut out last week with no catches. But if they can get him the ball, get Callaway going, he can be a dangerous player.
Well, junior out of Fort Valley, Georgia, had a 216-yard receiving game last year against Kentucky. He's been solid for them again this year. That Harris pass deflected at the line of scrimmage. Tip by Landon Stokes.
Treon Harris is a 5'10", maybe 5'11". Those throws over those big offensive linemen, and they are big for sure for this football team. They're always a problem. Reasons why they get him outside the pocket, and he's more productive rolling to his right.
They're giving him some help, too, in the background, Anthony, from Taylor and Scarlett. They won't have Jordan Cronkright, their third back, until the second half. He is sitting out after a targeting ejection last week. To the 30 goes Brandon Powell, the sophomore out of Deerfield Beach. One of the things that Coach Jim McElwain has talked about with this group is ownership of this team, responsibility, looking out for each other, taking care of each other. And he had a great line this week. He says, it's an everyday commitment for us, not just Saturdays in the swamp. This is their day to shine, but it's the hard work the other 6 days where it really pays off. And are they going to get off a snap here before the end of the quarter?
There's no foul. That's the end of the quarter.
6-0 Florida with the lead over Vanderbilt. On what might be a big day for the Gators, a chance to clinch the East. They set the tone early with their strong defense and then worked it with Kelvin Taylor to get into the end zone, hoping to celebrate. But at the end of the day, the College World Series last year, as were the Vanderbilt Commodores. They lost in the final to Virginia in Omaha. Third down and 7. Harris calls his own number, breaks a tackle and lunges to the 25, and a 5-yard gain there, a couple yards short. We've already seen him going for it on fourth down today.
Yeah, now you got a kicking situation, so you're probably not going to lean on the kicker, but might be a good opportunity to give him a chance.
Let's see, they're going to give McInnis, who missed the PAT earlier, an opportunity to make this one. He won a tryout during the bye week 2 weeks ago. He is a pre-dental student here at Florida. His last field goal attempt was in a high school all-star game 4 years ago. And they will utilize him on the fake. And they've got the first down. C.C. Jefferson, another defensive guy, getting in on the offensive side of the ball.
Well, when your kicking game is not in flux and play, make your some other plays on special teams. C.C. Jefferson gets the ball. The question is, did he fumble the football? Obviously, being a defensive lineman, doesn't handle the ball much. Practice this play many times. Vanderbilt, a lot of players are pointing. They have the football.
They sure are. Commodores come out with it.
And again, you don't have a kicking game. Your obvious kicker is out there. You have to do other things. And when you're pitching it to a defensive lineman, you see the ball swinging around. They strip it out. The question is, was the ball out before he was down? Referees right now calling, saying he was. I don't know if that ball was quite out yet. It looked like his rear was hitting the ground in that situation.
Caleb Azubake was the guy that yanked it out of there.
The ruling on the field is that the ball was recovered by the defense. The previous play is under further review.
And so they will review it. It certainly looks like Jefferson was down on that initial look. They will need indisputable video evidence to overturn it. Otherwise, it will stay with Vanderbilt on the takeaway.
Down, you don't see when the ball actually is coming loose because it's in front of a player. Again, doesn't show. You can't tell if it's in control of him. You do see it come loose, and he is down. But how soon did it come loose? And for me, if I'm Vanderbilt's defense, Beth, you got to think that there's a possibility that they could fake it or something could happen, because you have a kicker right now that shanks an extra point. You just got to be alert in those situations. And if they overturn this, they're going to get themselves a first down and could have had a chance to make a big stop if you're in defensive protective mode there.
The Florida special teams, we've seen a good kick return, a good punt return, and now possibly on the fake, they would need this to be reversed. Otherwise, it's Vanderbilt football.
And again, if we get that view that was pointing down almost in front of him, that seemed to be probably the best view to see the ball all the way down to his body. You can kind of time it up with maybe that other view of him laying on the ground. That's a big play. Again, it'd be a first down, close to a first down for sure for this offense who needs to get in the end zone and finish a drive.
Ruling on the field is a fumble. Vanderbilt ball.
Action review, the ruling on the field stands. First down, Vanderbilt.
And the ruling will stand.
And again, I just don't know if they can see when the ball was actually juggled out. You see it juggled out, but he's down. You just watch it here. Again, is the ball controlled there? Not controlled? Is he down? It looks like it comes loose right there when he's down, but it could have been juggling. Again, it's got to be indisputable. And right there, in their eyes, they didn't see it.
So a couple of times now in the red zone, the fumble and the fourth down stop for Vanderbilt, keeping this a one-score game. The fake to Ralph Webb and the pass broken up by Vernon Hargraves, who was thinking about a touchdown the other way, intended for Latavius Rayford.
Again, Hargraves is a shutdown corner. Just watch him read the quarterback's eyes, and then he locks in and he jumps that ball, and he's almost there before the wide receiver is. Tremendous ball skills, burst and explosion out of his back pedal. These are all things that NFL scouts are loving about this young man.
Four interceptions this year, an All-American a year ago. Projected if he comes out early, which is anticipated, he'd be a first rounder. Sims trying to get to the edge, and he will not get there as a flag flies. Coming up to make the hit, Antonio Morrison, their senior linebacker, the reigning SEC Defensive Player of the Week.
They're going to get their left tackle, Will Holden, here on a
holding. Offense, number 74. The penalty is declined. It's third down.
Jordan Sherritt right here. He is going to blow this play up and put the pressure on the tackle to hold him. Again, he's got that pressure on the inside. You've got to let your hands go. He's in good position, but Sherritt, with his speed up the field, puts the offensive tackle in a tough position in making that block.
Sophomore out of Tampa. They like to rotate in a lot of fresh legs up front. It's third and 15.
Delay a game. Offense. 5-yard penalty remains third down.
Well, that will set them back, and it's an offense so far in this first half. 13 rushes. They've only thrown the ball twice so far today. And after the penalty, it's third and 20.
You know, and I talked to Derek Mace before the game. He really believes college football, especially at the quarterback position, is about juniors and seniors. And when you have a sophomore in there now, you have a freshman in Kyle Shurmur, these guys aren't prepared in those situations. And when the clock goes down, you've got to be cognizant of that situation.
And Shurmur is emergency only today due to an injury. Stepping up. Incomplete out to midfield. Gators had that one well covered. And it's fourth down. So you get the takeaway, but you're unable to move it. And in fact, heading in the wrong direction. And an opportunity now for Callaway or Hargraves. Let's see who goes back deep here. It's Callaway.
Callaway is one of the most explosive players. You talk to the coaches, they say he is a real deal SEC wide receiver, and he's been doing it on special teams too.
Callaway gonna run up to it, take it off the bounce, and tackled out of bounds at the 45. 7 yards on that return. 6-0 Florida. They're working up an appetite for an SEC championship game appearance. Funds for each field goal and extra point kicked. Allstate has donated millions in scholarship funds. Third time in 4 drives that Florida will be starting in Vanderbilt territory in a 6-0 lead. A touchdown for Kelvin Taylor and then a missed PAT. Harris drops it off to Callaway, and he's got a first down, 11 yards on the pickup. How about Adnan with a Fighting Irish update?
Thank you, Beth. You know, the Irish have not missed a beat since Malik Zaire went out. Deshaun Kizer here, Torrey Hunter Jr. Kizer's thrown a touchdown every start this year. That'd be 7, 14-3 over Pitt. Beth?
Thank you very much, Adnan. Kizer, number 10 in the country in QBR since coming on, replacing Zaire. He's got some pretty good wideouts to work with there.
I made that big throw, touchdown throw against Temple last week, threw it in the turkey hole in between the corner and the safety to secure that victory in Philly.
Nice use of turkey hole. First down here for the Gators. A little misdirection with Taylor. Got tied up with his own offensive lineman. May have picked up a yard. Paul's got more on Taylor.
I had a chance to talk to Kelvin Taylor this week, and he told me that he wants to prove he's one of the best running backs in the SEC, and he thinks Jim McElwain is going to allow him to become one. He said once he found out more about McElwain and that he worked with Trent Richardson and Mark Ingram at Alabama, he knew instantly he had the credibility. It's all the little things, but the most important aspect of his game right now, he feels like he's so much more comfortable relying on his eyes, Anthony.
Yeah, you're right. And listen, his number one teacher has been his dad, Fred Taylor, one of the best rushers here at Florida. Played against him when he was at Jacksonville. And you see a little bit of his dad in him, but the one thing he does is, like you're right, it's patience and hitting the hole with explosiveness.
Movement up front by Ball start. Thurman.
Offense, number 63. It's a 5-yard penalty. Remains second down.
And the challenge for Taylor and company today is a Vanderbilt defense that's ranked 18th in the country against the run. And it's hard to keep drives moving against this D. They've been very good on third downs. Fifth best in the country, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, well, Derek Mason took over the defensive coordinator role. I don't know how hard he was looking to get someone to fill that void. He knows this personnel. Yep. And I think he wanted to be the mouthpiece. Outside of their two inside linebackers, they roll in 18 different players. So they're building depth on the defensive side of the ball.
And some pressure off the edge and the pass incomplete, overthrowing Powell. He was moving out of the backfield, and it's third down.
And those are those 90% throws, the ones you got to hit. You know, I do know Powell's obviously a 5'8 back in the slot, but you know, I think Jim McElwain plays to the strengths of his quarterbacks. If Will Greer's in there, they sprinkle some different things, being as a pocket passer. With Harris, they embrace his skill set. I think coaches sometimes get stubborn with players that come in, and they don't want to shuffle it around and make it suit the way the player plays. I think they've done a nice job with Harris, and he's protected the football, which I think has been vital.
They need the 24-yard line on third and 13. Harris, pressure coming. Gets away from Azubuike. Harris on the run. Lunging, and the ball pops out. Did he step out of bounds, or did it stay in play? Punched out of there by Landon Stokes. And Vanderbilt has recovered the football, their second takeaway. And coming into this game, the Gators had only 6 turnovers all season.
And Harris actually fumbled last week out of the pocket. Question is, did his left foot get touch out of bounds before Stokes knocks it out? Hard to see his foot there. Looks like it's still
looks
in.
Like he's in, yep.
And again, he's reaching for that first down, trying to get that little stretch to get it across the chains. And right there could have been costly. Huge, huge play by this defense.
Terrific play. Look at the chop in there with the arms. Landon Stokes. 2 first half turnovers. Very uncharacteristic for the Gators. And credit this Vandy defense. They've managed to keep this a one-score game, and things could have gotten ugly quickly.
You talk to this Gator coaching staff on offense, they knew what they were getting into with this Vanderbilt defense. And you talked about the accolades, being a top 20, 25 defense. Third down is where they really excel. And the turnover margin, that's been huge for really both of these teams. Florida's taking care of the ball, but right there, Vanderbilt plus 2 in this football game early.
Vandy has really hurt itself in that department this year, so a nice change for them thus far. Sherfield, the motion man, they haven't thrown a lot today. And under pressure and tossed out of bounds by McCrary. Caleb Brantley was coming after the quarterback. It's 3rd and 7.
Caleb Brantley's been a special player, sophomore for this football team. He's taking games over. When I turn the film on, one of the quickest guys off the snap to engage an offensive lineman, just has to do it every single play. Young player learning the way to play the game. Obviously, when you got a guy like Bullard next to you, number 90, that's doing it like that, he's going to grow and learn from him.
And Anthony, you think there's a lot of talent, perhaps Sunday talent, up front. They call it the money down here at the swamp. 3rd down for the Gator D. McCrary stepping up. He'll try and run for it. Gets out across the 25. It's going to be close. The spot has him right around the 29-yard line. Keanu Neal with the tackle.
Yeah, looks like it's going to be enough. And that's what McCrary brings to the table. He's not the fastest quarterback. But again, similar to Treon Harris, let's get to the first read. If it's not there, let's find some holes in between the offensive line and use your legs. Again, move the chains, long drives. If anything, if they don't score, they can change field position, which is good when you have a top-tier defense.
19 plays so far in the first half. 15 of them have been runs. Make it 16. Webb tripped up by Jonathan Bullard. The senior out of Shelby, North Carolina, passed up on a chance to turn pro last year. Didn't think he was going to go high enough, so he came back. And in his words, to get stronger and faster and better.
Well, last year he was a two-gap player, and he's right here. Now they're giving him some free range to hit the gaps and be a penetrator. And right there, if you don't cut him down, he's going to get through with that penetration. Kid's on a mission. You talk to him, he's hungry. He got that NFL letter last year, didn't like where they placed him in the potential draft. He said he's coming back to prove people wrong.
Some scouting services think he may be the top run stopper in the country. Not a whole lot of room up the middle, and a flag down. The carry for Sims. He ran into Antonio Morrison in the middle. Flag on the play.
Illegal formation on the offense. 5 players in the backfield. That penalty is declined. It's 3rd down.
Good news, you're not beating yourself with turnovers, but bad news, you found another way to hurt yourself with the penalties here in the first half for Vanderbilt.
Yeah, pinning yourself back. Again, the playbook gets minimal when you get in these situations with Vanderbilt. But right now, the defense, this is that money down you talked about. You get behind the chains. Bullard, but number 14, Alex McAllister, 6'6", on the bottom of your screen, number 14. He's got the longest arms on the football field. He's a big-time pass rusher.
He's coming. Gets taken down to the turf, but McCrary meets the same fate. Coming up out of the secondary, Jalen Tabor. 4th down.
These corners love to compete. Tabor, number 6, Wilson. Vernon Hargrave sets the tempo for the room.
And I think that's the most deepest position on this football team, and they're going to be set. They got two sophomores, Vernon obviously, a junior. Big time players for this defense.
They have forced five negative plays already from the Vanderbilt offense. Fourth and 15, Openshaw kicks it away. Callaway awaits from the 27. And he almost got out to the 45-yard line. It's a 15-yard return. 6-0, Gators on top. 7 wins in the SEC championship game. The Heisman winners, 3 of them on this 11-7-15. The date matching up with the numbers of Spurrier, Werfel, and Tebow. Yeah, most important, the 3 national championships, 96, 06, and 2008. That last national championship also matches up with their last SEC crown. And they can get back to the SEC championship game with a win today and represent the Eastern Division on the receiver's screen to Callaway. The lead, Anthony, could be a lot bigger. They've had some struggles.
They have. You got to finish the deal again. Dropping the ball there. Touches the ground on the slant. They miss the kick with their new kicker and his first kick of the day. And then because of that, they got to pitch it and have a shovel pass to a defensive lineman who gets stripped. And then, of course, Treon Harris down the sideline trying to get those extra yards for the first down. So, again, all these opportunities could have led to points in moving the football. All being wins for Vanderbilt's defense.
One turnover in 19 quarters for Florida, and now 2 here in the first half, the carry by Taylor across midfield.
Well, we saw the mishaps. The missed extra point by Neil McInnis. The positive energy by Jim McElwain, not rattled at all. He told the kid, don't worry, you'll get the next one. When Treon Harris fumbled that ball, on to the next play as well. You remember, guys, yesterday we sat down with McElwain. He said he doesn't want a bunch of Eeyores on his team, guys who mope around and look at the glass half empty. He wants some Tiggers. I guess the guy's a Winnie the Pooh fan.
He might be. They got the orange for sure in the jersey to show that off. But I think when you have those miscues, Beth and Paul, the problem is you leave a team like Vanderbilt hanging around.
Yes.
And that's the thing that's most important in this game.
Almost came out again there, but I think they're going to rule Taylor was down. Torin McGaster, one of the first guys there for the defense.
Every one of these defenders are tacklers. Corners come up. Even though the corner got blown up by the defensive lineman on that play when the Gators ran in the red zone, he still came up and took the hit. All of these players fight. They go hard, and they challenge the offense.
Johnny Townsend set to punt it away. He has been good all year long at pinning back the opposition deep in their own territory. And again, a punt that will allow his special teammates to get down there and put Vanderbilt down at their own 15. Just 1 yard on the return after a 34-yard boot.
Sure. And Dr. Pepper in college football. It's a one-of-a-kind tradition.
Well, part of the homecoming festivities yesterday in Gainesville. On this homecoming weekend, a 6-0 lead for Florida. It is now 29 consecutive drives for Vanderbilt without a touchdown. That's over 7 quarters worth. And they have not been able to get much going so far today. The run out across the 20-yard line gets some 6. How about an update from the Big Ten, Adnan?
Thank you very much, Beth. Updating on what's happening with Penn State Northwestern. So Clayton Thorson left the game. Zach Oliver's in to Christian Jones. Oliver's first touchdown pass of the year. 7-0 right now for the Cats on ESPNU, Beth.
All right. Thank you very much, Adnan. That would be a big blow for Penn State. We've seen them a few times. They are still just a game out of the race in the East. How about that drive from the defense for Florida? Jefferson making the play. The freshman out of Glen St. Mary, Florida.
Hey, he's making up for that shovel pass that they gave him the opportunity. This Vanderbilt offense has got to find ways to generate. Andy Ludwig has got a deep playbook. He's very accomplished coming from Wisconsin, the best rushing teams ever in the last couple of years, especially the Big Ten. 49 rush yards, only 55 total yards. That's not going to get it done, folks, against a Gators defense that's stout.
You got to go with Johnny McCrary because Kyle Schirmer, their other quarterback, is emergency only today with an injury. Flag down, quarterback down. Alex McAllister with the sack. Number two on the day for Florida.
Illegal formation. Offense. Five players in the backfield. Penalty is declined. It's fourth down.
Five possessions, five punts for Vandy.
It's really these two players, and we talked about McAllister, number 14. Look at the arm length, folks. It's hard to get your hands on him if you're a tackle, and he can reach behind and get that quarterback. This kid's only 240 pounds. He's a junior. He puts on another 20 pounds. He could become a freak.
Callaway. The stiff arm, and he cannot get away. Ladarius Wiley got him. A defensive struggle so far in Gainesville. Mason, not only the head coach, but the defensive coordinator, trying to fire up his guys. That unit actually has been pretty good so far in the first half, keeping this a one-score game with a couple of takeaways and a fourth down stop at the three-yard line here in the first half. And they force Harris out of the pocket as he wobbles one out of bounds.
Beth, I'll tell you what, these kids play hard on defense for this guy. Whatever he's preaching or whatever he's selling on the defensive side of the ball, they're buying in. I mean, you look at that improvement, folks. That's big time, especially you talk about the SEC, the teams he's got to play with. Now, last week against Houston, they were put in some sticky situations with four turnovers and short fields. But even there, the defense has really shown up and come to play. And right now, they've set the tone early in this football game against this Gator offense. The problem is he needs to get into that offense a little bit and get them fired up so they can move the ball.
Last year, his first year, he wanted to be a big picture guy. This year, he got back to the defensive side, his roots from his days at Stanford. Taylor, nice cutback, and then cut down out across the 45-yard line. And it looks like he's very close to the yard to gain. Ryan White tripped him up. Third down and one.
You look at this offense for Florida, and they feel like they're always on the verge of breaking a big play. Taylor's one of those guys. He can make those explosive plays. You talked about Antonio Callaway, 81. But Treon Harris, again, when it's not there, his legs, his defense has played well straight up right now of keeping him contained.
Taylor gets the call, and he's got the first down. About what's coming up at halftime, Adnan Burke.
All right, Beth, thank you very much. Coming up on the Lexus Halftime Report, a road test for the Irish as they're taking on Pitt after escaping against Temple a week ago. Also, quarterback dilemma perhaps for Florida State, Everett Golson or Sean McGuire. You'll hear the thoughts of Danny Cannell and Joey Galloway. And separation Saturday, not only Clemson, Florida State, but also LSU, Bama, Oak State, TCU. It's going to be a lot of fun, Beth.
Adnan, I bet you and Joey and Danny will be talking about the fact that they have taken very good care of the ball, Florida State. Robinson, the receiver, going to throw it back for the quarterback, Harris, and it's almost picked off by Landon Stokes. Incomplete.
That's great discipline by Stokes there. Not falling for the fake. Kind of saw something was up, just staying home, and is able to recover. Obviously, Robinson going to come back and throw this ball with a lot of air on it. 99 gets some time. He's just looking for the orange player right now. He sees the quarterback's eyes. Defenders look and see the quarterback's eyes or receiver's eyes at that token. He go up in the air, puts his hands up, knocks it down. Nice play by Stokes.
He's the guy that had the strip, caused the fumble earlier in the half. Taylor trying to cut the corner. Knocked out of bounds at the 45. The Gator bench wanted a flag for a late hit. They won't get it. 6-0, the Florida lead. Taylor with a 3-yard touchdown run. The only score thus far, missed PAT here at Ben Hill Griffin Stadium. Beth Mullins, 12-year NFL veteran, Anthony Becht, All-American, the national champion Laxman, Paul Carcaterra. Here is what is at stake. The SEC Eastern Division crown is at stake for the Florida Gators. They win this game, they will be in the SEC championship game in Atlanta on December 5th, their first trip since 2009. They actually, if they can't get it done today, have another opportunity next week. That's how big their lead is right now in the East. And on third down, the pass to Robinson is short.
Yeah, you know, I think the way the Florida Gators defense is playing right now, Vandy not doing able to do much, I got to think they're going to bring some of them big defensive linemen in and maybe go for this this play right here with some of the big boys.
I think McElwain's going to let the clock run down and then call the timeout. Or perhaps not. Brian Cox is in there in the backfield along with Taylor. Gonna go for it on fourth down. The bootleg, Harris. Weatherly giving chase. The pass for his tight end, McGee. And it is intercepted by Vanderbilt and Ryan White. The third turnover of the first half for Florida.
It's really been an absolute nightmare right now with this offense. Vandy's defense, Weatherly 45, chasing down the quarterback, making it tough, showing good speed. Looked like Coach McElwain wanted to have a timeout prior to that. Lets it roll out. Again, Harris has got no options here. Just throwing it up. Well, the best option sometimes is throwing it out of bounds. You see 14 White go up high, get the football. This defense has been impressive so far of containing this Gator offense. Fourth time throwing that football in the air like that. Got to protect yourself if you're Treon Harris.
He had been taking care of the football thus far, but a fumble, and now his first interception of the season. And can Vanderbilt make them pay? It's the Gainesville native, Ralph Webb, going the distance. Touchdown, Vanderbilt, 74 yards. And an extra point away from a lead over 10th-ranked Florida.
Talk about letting Vandy hang around. Defense is playing strong. Offense isn't clicking. Defense is back on the field. They got to make a stop. Vandy's really just trying to run this clock out. And lo and behold, they get a huge play to get themselves on the board and potentially take the lead here going into halftime.
Openshaw on for the extra point. Costly Florida miscues. Three giveaways in the first half, or from Vanderbilt's perspective, how about three takeaways? And this one, they cash in on.
Spencer Tully, the center, makes a big block. Really, nobody home. He's untouched all the way to the end zone. Gives Vanderbilt the 7-6 lead. Center and the guard, 53-77. 76 starts in between them, and there's a reason why, folks. Getting a huge hole for Webb. Look at that gaping hole. Listen, when you're untouched as a running back and you see green grass, you better show your speed. And when you live in Gainesville and came from Gainesville, you need to show the family and friends what you got. Right there, Webb with a big run. 11 rushes right now, 106 yards. Huge momentum builder for this Vanderbilt football team.
And that sigh of relief is from the Vanderbilt sideline. That snaps a streak of 30 drives in a row without a touchdown. Hayden Lukacs will kick it away. Off of the interception, which was thrown on the fourth down play, Vanderbilt goes the other way in a 7-6 lead. Well, this week on Sunday NFL Countdown, as Peyton Manning returns to Indy with the Denver Broncos, it turns out his impact ran far deeper than just on the field while he was with the Colts. Meet the dozens of high school football players named Peyton after their parents' favorite quarterback throughout the state of Indiana. That's Sunday NFL Countdown following NFL Insiders Sunday edition. All starts at 10 a.m. tomorrow on ESPN. A guy that turned it over a couple of times last year in Vanderbilt's home loss to Florida. Much different story in the first half today. Six turnovers through the first eight games for Florida, and now three here in the first half. Kelvin Taylor is offset. Harris throws, and the catch is made for the first down to DeMarcus Robinson.
And back to the touchdown. Number 42, Keanu Neal, one of their big-time haymaking tacklers on this football team. But what happens? The umpire gets in the way, creates an even bigger hole, and he gets picked off, not able to be in position to make a tackle there. So Vandy gets a little help, not only from the center guard, but umpire Rick Lowe gives him a little bump, too.
Not sure if that one will show up in the stat sheet, but Vanderbilt will take it. Looking to throw on first and 10. The legs of Harris getting him out of some trouble, but Stephen Weatherly finally caught up with him after Nehemiah Mitchell flushed him out of the pocket. That'll stop the clock. Vandy still has a couple of timeouts. Florida with three if they can move it up the field here.
You know, when they're in the pocket, I think for me, watching Treon Harris, you got to utilize the tight ends. 5 yard stick out routes over the football. Get that bunch look where you have three tight ends. Let these guys run some quick routes, hit them in the flats. Get your confidence in the quarterback position so he's not completely rolling out every single time. He's got to be able to make some hay in the pocket for this Gator offense.
Five receivers here for Treon Harris on second down. Harris stepping up and down he goes. The pressure coming. Torrey Agee, the junior from Opelika, Alabama. The first sack for Vandy. And it's third down. And Florida is going to call a timeout as Derek Mason continues to get fired up over there on that sideline. Well, this college football Saturday, there's all kinds of opportunities to watch multiple games on the Watch ESPN app. Put one game on your big screen. How about another on your computer? Another on your tablet? One more on your smartphone? Use Watch ESPN app. Just download the app or go to watchespn.com. How about during the 3:30 window? You could get all your smartphones and tablets and computers fired up and watch undefeated Clemson on ABC. Undefeated Houston on ESPN2 and undefeated Iowa on ESPN in the next window. Number 10 and one loss, Florida. Down to Vandy by an extra point here with 31 seconds to go in the half. And you're probably going to have to go the distance because you have not shown a lot of faith in your kicking game here in the first half. Third and 11 for Harris, and a flag is down. And he'll toss that one out of bounds. Looked like a hold on the offensive line.
Yeah, it's going to be the true freshman, Fred Johnson. He's getting his first start at right tackle today. And a little surprised that they called a timeout on third and long.
Holding offense, number 74. The penalty is declined. It's fourth down.
What it does is it gives Vandy a chance to catch a punt and potentially, you know, make a play. See 74 on the outside. Pass rush, trying to hold the pass rush up against Azubike. Just gets inside, beats him on the outside, and he has to grab. And fortunately, these are the lessons he'll learn being a true freshman. But they really like him now. He's a big boy. I saw him on the field. He's big arms, big body, good-looking kid.
Townsend, the punter, on to kick here for Florida. And a nice kick, a boomer, and a fair catch down at the 5 yard line by Ryan White. May have lost where he was on the field there. 57 yards will pin the Commodores back.
Yeah, big mistake. Your heels got to be at 10 if the ball goes over your head, which a booming punt it was. You got to let that one go. Unfortunately, now you pin yourself back and really have no option here except go into halftime. But at the end of the day, you're up 7-0 or 7-6. And I think that's huge. You talk about all the ups and downs this offense has had. They get the big spurt, the big run, but the defense has been the story.
The defense that has forced three turnovers has a stop inside the 5 yard line on fourth down. And then Ralph Webb, the sophomore from right here in Gainesville, a 74-yard touchdown run off of that last takeaway. And they will take a knee. We will hear from Paul Carcaterra with Coach Jim McElwain coming up in the Lexus halftime report. It is 7-6 Vanderbilt over Florida. Ralph Webb, 74 yards on a score and a strong performance by the Commodores defense and Florida's as well, for that matter. Let's get you to Adnan Virk, Joey Galloway, and Danny Cannell in the studio. Homecoming weekend at Florida, and homecoming weekend for the pride of the Gainesville High School Hurricanes. Ralph Webb, the longest run at Vanderbilt in 3 years, and he's got the Commodores on top 7-6. You're watching College Football presented by Cars.com. And on a day when a win here for the Florida Gators gets them a berth in the SEC championship game, three turnovers in the first half were costly, and it's a 7-6 lead. Beth Mowins, along with 12-year NFL veteran Anthony Beck, Paul Carcaterra, also with us. The turnovers very costly for a team that usually takes very good care of the ball.
You're right. Now, I've been impressed with Vanderbilt's defense. They've come out and really have played lights out for head coach Derek Mason, who's really taken the strongholds and made the calls this year, and they're really living up to the bill.
The defense we knew for both sides coming in was going to be the strength of these two units. Florida has also done their job. 27 plays for Vanderbilt. 23 of them have been runs, including the 74-yard touchdown for Webb. And they will receive here to start the second half. The chance to spoil the party. They thought here in Gainesville they might be celebrating their first trip back to the SEC championship game for the first time in 6 years. On the return, it's going to be Darius Sims who loses his footing, and he's down inside the 15-yard line. Well, they had a really good play for a touchdown from Webb. Other than that, not a whole lot going on. Just the 6 passing yards on 4 attempts and 8 negative plays.
Yeah, and that's been really the difference. And the passing game has been nowhere to be found. Only 6 passing yards for Johnny McCrary for Vanderbilt. Third down has been big in this football game. That's the problem. 9.5 yards to go on third down. They've got to find ways to win on first and second down if they can get and continue to keep this lead against this Gator football team.
McCrary on first down. This is Sims. Picked up a couple. Vanderbilt, can they do it again? They came in here 2 years ago and beat Florida the first time they had won at the Swamp since 1945. Florida has owned this rivalry, winners of 23 of the last 24. But it's a one-point lead for the visitors, and Derek Mason, who has one SEC win on the resume. They beat Missouri earlier this year, trying to take down a top 10 foe on the road. Is Webb, and he runs into some Gators that got into the backfield, led by Alex McAllister and Jared Davis.
And again, they don't win on first and second down, and you get your kickoff returner slipping down, so they're even farther back. Field position, where that ball's going to be, and taking the stress off Vandy's defense is going to be key in this second half. I expect the Florida Gators offense to be much better, but this Florida Gators defense continues to play with a lot of stop play up front. Their secondary has yet to been challenged in the passing game. They can't fall asleep and let a big one go through.
They got their dime package in there. On the money down, third and 11. McCrary, down he goes. Alex McAllister, sack number 3 on the day for Florida, and it's fourth down.
Freak athlete. 6'6", long arms, and he's going to loop inside and just watch the athleticism. Again, the left right guard doesn't come off to make the block. He feels his presence run by him. By that time, it's too slow. McAllister gets himself a big play.
Punt is away out of the end zone. Contact with the punter. There is a flag. Callaway, what a dodge to get himself free inside the 35 and down to the 34. 23 yards on the return, but a flag was down in the end zone. Contact with the punter. It was Chris Thompson that got in on Openshaw.
Running into the kicker, defense number 18. It's a 5-yard penalty. Replay the down.
Running is better than roughing from the Florida perspective. It will stay fourth down.
It's very close, very fortunate there. They could have went the other way. Goes right at through the legs. Again, you always see when you get hit in the leg like that in the kicker and his body turns violently like that, you can easily call that a personal foul. That was close.
That looked like that was pretty full speed
it
coming
was.
Right at his leg.
And when you're coming scot-free, he didn't really look like he was trying to go full at him and block it, and he just runs right through his leg. That could have easily been called a personal foul.
Instead, it will remain fourth down. Openshaw again in his end zone. Callaway out near midfield. Sixth punt of the day for him. Callaway with some space. Down he goes at the 46. 8 yards on that return.
Yeah, early in the game, the miscues. You see the drop ball there on fourth down. They're having a kicker situation. They miss the extra point. Because of that, they have to fake a fourth down on the field goal opportunity. And they fumble, pitching it to a defensive lineman. Treon Harris, who's protected the football well this season, gets a fumble and then also throws an INT on a fourth down, which wouldn't have been a big issue. But Vanderbilt scores on the next play on a touchdown run by Webb.
That was his first interception toss of the year. Again, Florida coming in one of the best at ball security in the country with 6 turnovers through 8 games, but 3 of them in that first half. Out of the pistol, it's Kelvin Taylor. Gets back to the line of scrimmage, that's it. Paul Carcaterra.
Beth, before the third quarter, I caught up with Vanderbilt head coach Derek Mason. He thinks he's getting to Treon Harris, the Florida quarterback. He said multiple looks. They'll go pressure, no pressure, zone, man-to-man. And Anthony, one of the key things with Treon Harris is his ability to escape out of the pocket. He feels like he's not allowing him to get into a flow because all the little bit of mind games.
You're right. This offensive line needs to be challenged at halftime for Florida. One returning starter, the right guard. Everyone else is brand new. They got to state their claim and win the line of scrimmage in the second half.
Harris, incomplete, looking for Showers. He took a pretty good hit as well from Darian Herring, going out of bounds. Got the towel knocked off him.
Yeah, I mean, he's got that tremendous ability to really extend the play. When you're staying in bounds, you give a defender an opportunity to take a shot when you're in bounds. Right there, Herring's going to take his chances when he can in a legal way.
Well, you talk about the decisions that he needs to make, maybe getting rid of it a second sooner there so he doesn't take a lick. Inside and outside the pocket so far for him. Inside, 6 for 10, 97 yards.
Yeah, inside, they've had some nice crossing routes across the middle. Haven't been able to get back to that. Got a penalty on the second big play. Need to be more effective in the pocket.
Against just a 3-man rush, they'll drop 8 and now come after the quarterback and get him. Herring was there along with Nehemiah Mitchell, their second sack, and it's fourth down.
And this is what's been so good about Treon Harris at the quarterback position, being able to elude that extra guy, not dump it down. The 35 is going to come up and make a big play. But here's the difference. He looks to the right. Okay, he doesn't see anything there. Right now, you make your move and you run. He tries to create something else, and Herring's not buying it. He's going to sit there. He's going to spy him like he did on that play, and he's going to be in position to make a tackle for his defense.
Pre-snap whistle. Derek Mason is livid on the far sideline.
Illegal substitution by the defense, 12 players on the field. It's a 5-yard penalty, remains fourth down.
Let's see where that will spot the ball now at the 46-yard line for the punt. This may cost them down at the other end in field position if Townsend continues to do his job well.
The returner, Ryan Waite, has to make a better decision on catching the balls behind the 10-yard line, which he's doing now.
Drops inside the 5 and then squirts into the end zone. 46 yards on that boot. Vanderbilt with the ball in the lead when we come back to the Swamp.
Who's in?
Who's in?
Who's in?
New Year's Eve?
I'm in.
I'm in.
We're in.
You know I'm in.
Who's in for the Cotton Bowl and the Orange Bowl, the semifinals on New Year's Eve this year? Just 5 weeks remaining in the regular season, and the first rankings are out with Clemson at number one. LSU and Alabama, 2-4, they will meet tonight. Notre Dame leading Pittsburgh right now in their game.
Yeah, and I'm not sure I agree with Alabama in the top four. I think TCU's a bit high at 8. I think they're a lot better team than that. Again, they're going to have an opportunity to prove themselves. But again, it's early, Beth.
That's the college football playoff rankings brought to you by Allstate. And Webb spinning out to about the 25-yard line. His touchdown run, a 74-yarder. The difference right now in a one-point lead for Vanderbilt. Of course, Florida trying to secure a spot in the SEC championship game with a win here today. There's a lot of work left out west, though, with Alabama and LSU and Ole Miss still all in the mix.
You're right. I mean, you talk about this side of the conference in Florida this early in November with a huge opportunity. Coach McElwain has really talked about it with his teammates and said, listen, you got to grasp this and take it.
Webb secured by Brian Cox right at the 25. And it's going to be third down and 5.
Manageable position for this Vanderbilt offense. Brian Cox Jr. again plays both sides, gets in on that heavy package on offense, but he's been a quiet force for this football team on defense. A tremendous pass rusher, plays just like his dad, relentless, comes off the edge with effort, gives you a high motor on every single play, and it's been a big factor for this Gator defense.
Pressure coming from the edge, and they'll run it up the middle. Dallas Rivers has the first down for Vanderbilt as they continue to churn it away on the ground. Still just the 4 passes this afternoon.
Coach Mason's been pretty fired up in this whole entire game.
I think he may have tried to call a timeout right there prior to the snap. Didn't get it, and his team got the first down.
I was about across the field from Coach Mason on that 40-yard line. He was running up and down the sidelines, begging for a timeout. Good thing he didn't. The run game has been the strength of this Vanderbilt offense, only 6 yards passing. He told me at halftime he's going to continue to pound the ball with Ralph Webb. He said Ralph Webb's a superstar. He belongs on this stage.
Here comes Morrison trying to get into the backfield. Rivers. And again, it's Davis and Brian Cox Jr. Bringing some mayhem from that front line, Brian is today.
Yeah, I'll tell you, you know, I remember playing with his dad when I was with the Jets, big time defensive end. The guy was a great leader, huge, huge, big time hitter in the NFL. And we had the same agent, so I was happy for him to be on my side when I was a rookie in the locker room.
3rd and 8. McCrary. Oh, Cox almost got to him. And he will clean it up. 4 sacks on the day for the Gators. And a flag down on the far side. Looks like it might be a false start.
Illegal formation. Offense. 5 players in the backfield. That penalty is declined. It's 4th down.
That's the 3rd time they've had 5 guys in the backfield. 4th down coming up. Cox doing his thing.
Yeah, Brian Cox right here. He's been a tremendous force. Again, relentless. Look at the work, the effort. He's not the most athletic like McAllister, but he's going to continue to fight. Finishes his just like his dad did a long time ago and when I was with the Jets. Yeah.
Open shot, boots it away, off a hop. Callaway. Another nice return, breaking a tackle out across the 45 and close to midfield. And a 31-yard return after the 49-yard punt. We'll take the timeout with the team. So well-deserved break for Brian Cox and that Gator defense. A 1-point Vandy lead. watching the SEC on ESPN. A defensive struggle today in Gainesville on a hot and steamy day at the Swamp. Florida's offense struggling against this Vandy D. They've turned it over three times this afternoon. And the field position for both sides much better for Florida. Can they cash in on another good spot here to start out the drive? And the false start for David Sharp will set them back into their own territory.
False start. Offense. Number 78. Five-yard penalty. First down.
This is their fifth position. They're starting across midfield, but only one touchdown to show for it. And this isn't helping matters. Their last six drives, three punts, three giveaways, and 135 yards of total offense.
And their left tackle, David Sharp, didn't start this game. He was banged up. They bring him in now and bounce number 75, Halter, to the right side, trying to get something going at the offensive line.
Taylor gets back to the original line of scrimmage. Edman Virk's got a Notre Dame pit update.
Indeed, Beth, I want to let you know that CJ ProSize left the game in the first half. He still has not returned. This is Jordan Whitehead here for the Panthers. So it's 21-10 on ABC. Beth, Anthony, back to you guys.
Thank you, Adnan. As the injuries continue to mount for Notre Dame. Just one loss. They're the team on the outside looking in, number five in the rankings.
Coach Brian Kelly's done a nice job of getting backup players to step up and play big for his football team.
Second 11, blitz coming up the middle. It's picked up. Taylor on a bounce to the edge. All down at the 44-yard line. Four-yard gain. It'll be third and about seven. Zach Cunningham with the tackle.
How about him? Sideline to sideline. You talked to Coach Derek Mason about him. He thinks he's the most underrated linebacker in the country. And right there, about that speed. Taylor dips in, bounces outside, and he comes running and doesn't sell and sells out on the play. It's a big-time play for 41. He's going to be a star for this team. Again, third and seven in this opportunity. Tight ends to me. We're waiting a long time for Treon Harris to get the ball out of his hands. You got number 83 in the football game right here. Let's try to find him, get him the football in that seven-yard area, make it easy for your quarterback.
Goolsby's got one catch. I think that's it for the tight ends. On the rollout, throws it out of bounds. So the Vanderbilt defense comes up with a third down stop. And seven of their last eight times against the Gators, and that is the quarterback, Treon Harris, who is down on the ground after a hit from Azubike.
Again, rolling into his left really is not a favorable passing situation for a right-handed quarterback. This is what Vanderbilt talked about on defense. We want to make him a left-handed or a left-side throwing quarterback. And right there, Vandy's defense is not going to be fooled when they roll to either side, and it was well covered by their secondary.
Another punt for Townsend. Ryan White standing at his own 10-yard line.
Delay of game. Offense. Five-yard penalty. Fourth down.
That may be to give Johnny a little more room. Last one he dropped inside the five, but then found its way into the end zone. Couple of them inside the 20 that he's dropped. High end over end. It's going to be short. White will step up and make the fair catch at the 17-yard line. Treon Harris got roughed up on that last pass play. He's sitting on the sideline right now. It's a one-point Vandy lead.
ESPN College Football is brought to you by Northwestern Mutual, proud to be an official financial planning partner of the NCAA. And Chick-fil-A, we didn't invent the chicken, just the chicken sandwich.
The pageantry of the homecoming parade yesterday. Supposed to be a big weekend and a party today in Gainesville, but right now Vanderbilt with other plans. The 7-6 lead on the Ralph Webb 74-yard touchdown run and a missed PAT for Florida after Kelvin Taylor's score in the first half. The defenses have dominated and the Scamper by Darius Sims for the Commodores. Today on ABC at 3:30 Eastern, it's Clemson and Florida State presented by K Jewelers. Then at 8 o'clock tonight, Ohio State and Minnesota presented by Walmart. Both those games also streaming live on Watch ESPN. The undefeated Tigers, number one in the country, and Ohio State, the defending champs, number three. And, of course, Clemson, that huge game in Death Valley against Florida State as they run it with Webb again. If the Tigers win today, they would clinch the ACC Atlantic and head to the championship game in the conference. The last time they started out 9-0, by the way, was in 1981 when they won the national title.
And Florida State's their last hurdle as their schedule tapers down a bit after there, so they'll be in good shape to hold that position, hopefully at number one.
Knowles have won the last three in that rivalry, and it's third and one here for Vandy. Webb offset. Blitz coming from the secondary. They trip up the running back, Marcus May. And it will depend on the spot as Webb stumbled forward.
It looks like it's going to be a little short, but number seven, Webb. The safety coming into this action here in this run game. Marcus May doesn't get a lot of acclaim, probably the least acclaim of all the defensive backs, but he is a key component of this defense. Really a ton of leadership with this football team in the back end. Mason, offensive line, offensive teams pinned back. This could be an opportunity here where you might not snap it. You might have a freeze play, try to get him to jump off sides. Or if you're Vanderbilt, you're thinking this is an opportunity to make a statement.
The spin, lunging forward. It was Jared Davis that had a chance to blow it up, and Webb picks up the first down.
Heck of a job by Ralph Webb to avoid that what potentially would have been a huge blow up hit by Davis, number four, the inside linebacker, and he just churns his way, getting that first down. 5'10", 202 pounds, but he's got some agility. That's great vision on the spot, getting the snap and the handoff and being able to twist and turn. Pretty impressive by Webb today.
Needed one, he got two. He's up to a buck 16 on the day. Here he goes again, stuffed at the line, Paul.
Well, Beth, you saw Treon Harris last time out there, a little nicked up. Trainers were working on his right calf, but a big defensive loss right now. Keanu Neal, starting safety. He actually went down with an ankle injury, had a lot of tape on it, tried running, hurt, went back to the training table. They reevaluated, taped him again. He had his helmet on. It looks like he's ready to go, but he's still not out there, Anthony. He's a huge loss. You like him like you like Major Wright, a past Florida Gate.
Yeah, he's in the box, guy, and number eight, Nick Washington, will replace him at the safety position.
And trying to run it right up the gut with Dallas Rivers into Brian Cox, a gain of five.
And you see the limitations right now for Vanderbilt's offense. You know, a quarterback right now that they just don't trust to make throws down the field. Hasn't had a real productive day today. Now third and short in this situation. Only four passes to 38 runs. That is a phenomenal disparity of an offense.
McCrary looking to throw it over the top. Incomplete. Intended for Chris Quintero. It was Duke Dawson who had the coverage, and it's fourth and four. They just went for it a moment ago on fourth and one.
To me, I'm not a fan of taking shots if you're Vanderbilt's passing offense. Let's try to get a productive four-yard pass route, a quick throw to a tight end, a slot receiver on the crossing route. Let's not rely on McCrary dropping a dime in to a fading receiver, which we haven't seen, or at least I haven't seen on tape in about 4 or 5 weeks.
Callaway drifting back to the 14-yard line. Getting by the first wave. Nice moves to get out across the 30 to the 32-yard line. 20 yards on that return after the 51-yard punt. And there is a penalty flag down as well around the 40-yard line.
After the play, personal foul by the kicking team number 56. It's a 15-yard penalty added on to the end of the run. First down.
That's Barrett Gauger after the play with the personal foul.
Dirk Mason got in his grill and teaching him and telling him, listen, we can't do this. Vanderbilt is not a team that can overcome these huge penalties. And Callaway has done a fantastic job of getting this offense in some great field position today. Gators got to step up here offensively and finish the drive if they have a chance to win this game.
204 yards of total offense today for the Gators as we get close to the end of the third quarter. Harris, no time at all. The rush coming off the edge. And the third sack of the day. Nephi Lealo, Zach Cunningham getting in Harris's face.
Nephi getting his first start today. You got to block him, though. He's an unblocked guy. If he's not blocked, then there's got to be a hot route, and the quarterback's not on the same page. So it's either a protection issue or Harris has to release the football to a quick receiver.
Loss of sixth on the play. Jordan Scarlett now in at tailback. Callaway in motion. Scarlett. Wrapped up in the backfield, spins out of it. And back-to-back negative plays caused by this Vanderbilt defense. Cunningham was the first guy there again to the studio in Adnan.
Thank you very much, Beth. An update on Notre Dame and Pitt over on ABC. Deshaun Kaiser to Will Fuller. 14-yard score, third touchdown of the day for Fuller. They've been great today, 28-10. Beth, back to you.
Thank you very much, Adnan. The Vanderbilt defense continues to do its thing. Minus 21 yards for Florida on its last two plays.
Zach Cunningham has been unblockable in this game, and he's letting his rest of the defenders swarm into the football. And right now, Vanderbilt, they can do anything on offense. It could be a big problem.
A rush three. They'll still get some pressure to flush Harris out. He fires downfield incomplete, looking for Callaway. Caleb Azubake getting in the backfield, and it's another punting situation for the Florida Gators.
Again, you can get a quick dump down to a running back, get some yards, and change the field. Not a real optimal play there down the sidelines for the quarterback.
Instead of Ryan White, it's Darius Sims back to receive the punt. And a fair catch for Sims at the 21-yard line, a 55-yard punt. Time now for today's Aflac trivia question. And what have we got for the folks at home? With a win, Jim McElwain can clinch the SEC East in his first season as the head coach here at Florida. Who are the other two coaches to advance to the SEC championship game in their first season? A couple of guys. I think this will be the 24th year of an SEC championship game. Who else has gotten there in his first season? McElwain trying to get the Gators there after replacing Will Muschamp.
Defense has really kept them in this ball game because of the lack of performance of the Gators offense. And I'm expecting you could potentially get a big turnover here and change this game if you're the Florida Gators.
Prairie. Not giving their secondary a chance for a pick on that one. He'll toss it out. Any thoughts on the Affleck? Maybe Paul's got a hint for us, or he's got the answer.
Luckily, I have some short-term memory. I think Gus Malzahn just a few years ago.
Oh, that's a good guess.
And always there's that home team kind of connection. So I'm going to say Steve Spurrier and Gus Malzahn.
All right. I think Malzahn is probably one of them. Did Saban do it in his first year at Alabama?
I think Paul's got Google down there. He's just typing in the question.
Turnover-prone Vanderbilt has not been that way so far today. Webb with the carry. And it's third down coming up as we tick away the final seconds of the third quarter. Not only the trivia answer when we come back, but are the Florida Gators a quarter away from the SEC championship game, or Vandy a quarter away from a huge upset? College football presented by cars.com. Kelvin Taylor, a 3-yard run in the first quarter. Ralph Webb, a 74-yard run in the second quarter. And that is it for both offenses today as we start the fourth. And 10th ranked Florida in some trouble. Both defenses, Anthony Becht, have dominated the day. And offensively for Vandy, Ralph Webb, 117 yards on the ground. The rest of the team, 30 yards total.
And Jared Davis right there is just spying McCrary. And basically keeping his eyes on McCrary's been ineffective today. He's only had one completion, and it hasn't been to a receiver. It was to a running back out of the backfield. And number 10, Trent Sherfield, their number one receiver, hasn't played the whole second half.
Playing away, it's Vernon Hargreaves back deep. Tips it to himself. A couple of shakes and down he goes at the 28-yard line. 7-6, Vanderbilt with the lead. And the other story today, Anthony Beck, for the Florida Gators, 6 turnovers in their first 8 games, but 3 of them in the first half, and they have not been able to get much going here in the second half.
Well, where's Kelvin Taylor? Not a lot of running game. This offensive line has been being beat in the trenches right now by this Vanderbilt defensive line. And for Treon Harris, the quick passing game. They did some early crossing routes. They got some wide open receivers. They have not got it there. And as the quarters have gone through, minus 18 yards in the third quarter is just not good enough against a very good Vanderbilt defense.
Taylor, a few yards off the right side. Kelvin, so far on the day, 13 rushes, 40 yards. They have run for 76 total today. It's a Gator team with a 2-game lead in the SEC East. A win today or a win next week against South Carolina, they are in the SEC championship game. They would obviously like to take care of that piece of business here in the fourth quarter. Harris throws, and it's caught by Robinson. Stays on his feet. Gets back to the middle of the field and down at the 50. 18 yards on that strike. Good run after the catch as he got away from Trey Herndon.
They got the explosive players on offense. They got DeMarcus Robinson. They got 81 Callaway. They got to get these guys the ball right there. Nice throw and catch within the pocket. Probably the best one of the day for Treon Harris.
Pressure coming up the middle. It's picked up by Florida. Taylor into Vandy territory. Well, Monday Night Football comes your way from the West Coast with Jay Cutler and the Chicago Bears heading out to San Diego to take on Philip Rivers and the Chargers. Could be a high-scoring affair. a fair out at the queue. Coverage begins with a Monday night countdown at 6, and it's also streaming live on Watch ESPN.
Two teams trending downward, really, Beth, in the NFL, and for the Chargers, been probably the most disappointing. Keenan Allen, their star wide receiver, out for the season. Yeah. So that's been a huge blow for Philip Rivers and company.
Tough one to take for San Diego. Harris. There's another check down with his feet. And it's the right read by the sophomore quarterback to the 35.
And that's the difference right there. One, if it's not there, get your legs and speed up the field and take those holes and openings this defense gives you. Vanderbilt defense has done a nice job of closing in quickly, but you see the speed of Harris. If he decides to go now, he's hard to catch to get those chains moving. Been their best drive so far this half.
A field goal can get you the lead, but what is that field goal range with the Florida kicking issues? They've tried a walk-on that they picked up 2 weeks ago so far today. First down. They may not have to worry about it as Powell gets loose inside the 20. Terrific block by Mason Halter, and it's a 17-yard gain.
Well, Brandon Powell started this entire game off with some special teams and a nice run. Russell, right tackle, number 75, with the big block on the corner to spring a big play for Powell up the sidelines. A little juice right now from this Gator offense.
Callaway, the wide out to the short side of the field, the top of the screen. Power backfield, they'll motion Goolsby out. Harris with the play action, gonna go with it again. Throws it at the last minute out of bounds and took another good lick, that time from Williamson. Down to Paul.
You know, Beth, it's interesting, not until they got within the 20-yard line that their kickers are actually warming up. They haven't used that kicking apparatus next to the 20-yard line at all. So they're looking to punch it in. This offense needs to cash in the red zone with a touchdown because of their kicking woes.
Number 34 is Neil McInnes, the dental student, who answered a tweet from the football staff that they were looking for a kicker due to inaccuracy and injury to their other two kickers. He missed a PAT, and then they did not go to him on a fake field goal attempt. Robinson, Bow squirts free, down on the deck. And Vanderbilt has its fourth takeaway of the day.
Sometimes as a wide receiver, you got to know when the fight is over. And maybe a little extra effort might be too much in a circumstance. And right there, DeMarcus Robinson has a huge catch a couple plays before, makes somebody miss, and now his mindset feels that he can do even more. The ball squirts out on that extra effort. It's a tough deal right there. That was the Florida Gators' best drive of the second half, and you'll see, again, nice block. Callaway trying to get these guys open. Right now, you got four or five guys there, and it gets poked out by Woods, Jay Woods, number 74, and it's been one of those days of turnovers and miscues right now for this offense.
Two red zone turnovers and a fourth down stand for the Vandy defense. And the Swamp feeling the heat. You're watching the SEC on ESPN. 90,000 in attendance here in Gainesville after Florida jumped on top with a Kelvin Taylor touchdown in the first quarter, a missed PAT, and that's all they've been able to muster. Ralph Webb's 74-yard touchdown run, the Gainesville native, has Vandy on top. He got that late in the second quarter. Webb is the deep back. He'll get the call. It has been a run-heavy attack all day long for Vandy. As we get back to our Aflac trivia question, if Jim McElwain and the Gators win today, he will join two other guys, Les Miles and Gus Malzahn, as head coaches that win an SEC division title in their first season and go on to play for the SEC championship.
And right now he's got his work cut out for him. And to be honest with you, any team in the country that turns the ball over four times, that other team would probably have between 15 to 28 points scored. Well, the ineptness of Vanderbilt's offense right now has been a big issue and kept the Florida Gators in this game.
McCreary thought about it. Now we'll run with it. Gets out of bounds, and a flag will tag on extra yardage. It looked like, in fairness to Antonio Morrison, he was trying to slow down and couldn't do it. And now McCreary is slow to get up. Their other quarterback, who he has split time with, Kyle Shermer, we were told pregame he is emergency only today because he has an injury. Looks like McCreary's going to stay in there.
Personal foul. Late hit out of bounds by the defense. 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
They were fortunate earlier on the punt, not getting the roughness. And here, almost looks like he was trying to hold him up, and he just fell forward, and it looked like a big hit. So, unfortunately for him, the best thing is just stay away from the QB. And that's going to be a big play for an offense that has done zero in this football game today.
Penalty gets him the first down. Now to the 29. Just 150 yards of total offense for Vanderbilt. Webb may get another yard on that carry. Jordan Sherritt with the stop.
Right now, the Florida Gator defense is not respecting any of the outside receivers. They have eight players in and around the box. They're going to try to take away Webb, who's really manufactured the only offense for this football team. Only seven passes today, 42 rushes, and it's worked for them right now. But again, they have not been able to capitalize on the turnovers that the defense has created for them.
Couple of tight ends to the right side of the line. A handoff right up the middle, and he's wrapped up immediately by Jared Davis and thrown for a loss. Adnan's got an update on Notre Dame.
We have one for you here, Beth. This is Deshaun Kizer once again making sweet magic. First and goal. It's Josh Adams, a 5-yard touchdown. How about them Irish on ABC, 35-17. Beth?
So Notre Dame, the Irish, number 5 in the first college football rankings out this week. Coming up next on ABC, Florida State, Clemson, and then tonight at 8 o'clock, Ohio State and Minnesota. A couple of unbeaten teams still on the slate. Third and 11. Referee Brad Rogers coming over to the sideline. This may be a communications issue with the headsets on the Vanderbilt sideline, is what we've been told. Derek Mason said, "Hey, I can't talk to anybody. On these headsets, not working, but his team still got a 1-point lead." And he's got it out to the 40-yard line. Pickup of 12.
I like that play call right there. Again, the inability to throw the football. You have really two options: run the football with Webb or use your quarterback's legs. And right there, nice blocks up in between the middle. You see the defensive line slant inside. And again, McCreary is a big guy, 6'4", 225 pounds. Not the easiest cat to bring down. So you see him there lunge through and get that extra yards, driving his shoulder through the defender.
Needed 11. He got 12. Under 8 minutes to play. Hitter to his receiver. Short gain. Well, today on ESPN, how about the undefeateds in the Big Ten? Number 9, Iowa, taking on Indiana at 3:30 on ESPN, presented by Cars.com. Then unbeaten Michigan State at Nebraska, presented by Hilton Hotels. That's tonight at 7. Who's into the college football playoff? New Year's Eve, the semifinals, the Cotton and the Orange. about a month away from Selection Day on December 6th. Five more weeks of football starting today. Looks like a cramp down there for one of the Gators. Caleb Brantley, their starting defensive tackle. The defenses have ruled the day. And Vanderbilt with a 7-6 lead. Here in Gainesville, Beth Mowens, Anthony Beck, Paul Carcaterra. 10th-ranked Florida on the ropes, Vanderbilt. One top 10 win since 1974. And they're working on another one here. It's been the ground game all day long. This is Sims with their 45th rush on 53 plays. They only have 9 passing yards today. But what they do have is the longest run against the Florida defense all year, the 74-yard scoot from Webb.
It's a great tackle by the Florida defense. Morrison's done a nice job. That play almost got outside on the perimeter there. Great team speed by this Florida Gator defense. And again, third and long situations have not been favorable. McCrary using his legs on the last conversion. Let's see what they go to here.
Flags down, delay a game.
Delay a game, offense, 5-yard penalty, remains third down.
You're going to back yourself up in a view reference, Anthony. You don't have a whole lot of options when you've completed one pass in your last 42 plays. Where do you go here on third and 12?
I would have told you McCrary would be 2 completions with 9 yards in this football game. With 6 minutes left in the fourth quarter, you probably say Florida is up big time in this football game. Right now they're trying to play it safe. Derek Mason said, look, we're going to run the ball. We can't let the quarterback put us in a situation. We might get a turnover.
And a timeout. So a delay of game and follow it up with a timeout. 2 left for Vanderbilt, 5:47 to play. Here in the swamp, can the Commodores finish it off? Welcome back to Gainesville. The SEC East looks like this. The Gators with a 2-game lead. They need a win today or next week against South Carolina to get into the SEC championship game. Can they take care of business today? They're down a point. 5:47 to go and a 3rd and 12 for Vandy. It's Ralph Webb, and flags are down before the running back even leaves the backfield. And another penalty on Vandy. They've gone penalty, timeout, penalty here on this third
ball
down.
Start. Offense, number 75. 5-yard penalty, remains third down.
So the right tackle just oofed too early, and again, you're right, you're coming off a timeout, you're dialed in, everybody knows the situation. And for Vanderbilt here, you know, be smart. Don't do anything crazy. I would definitely assume another run here, punt it away. And listen, your defense has done it for you this game. And don't want to cause any concern with a potential turnover or doing anything silly here. Be conservative in this situation.
They will go that route and run it with Webb, and it'll run right into the Gator front. Jonathan Bullard to the studio. Adnan.
All right, thank you very much, Beth. Just want to update you what's happening with Saquon Barkley here. Penn State Northwestern. Well, here comes Penn State, 21-20 right now on ESPNU as they take the lead early in the fourth quarter. Once again on ESPNU. And coming up, Deshaun Watson. You heard Rick Ross say he's the best quarterback in the country. That was on game day. They're taking on Florida State. It's coming up on ABC. Beth?
Well, you got to follow Rick Ross's lead on that one. Undefeated Clemson and Florida State. In the next window, the Tigers win it. They clinch the Atlantic in the ACC.
Yeah, they definitely deserve to be the top team offensively, defensively. I think the most efficient team in the country, and you know, a huge win against Notre Dame. And right now they got a huge opportunity against Florida State to really state their claim in the ACC.
Knowles went in there a couple of years ago when Clemson was ranked higher and blew their doors off. This is the 10th punt of the day for Vanderbilt, and it's not a good one at all. Do not believe that that one was tipped. Openshaw out of bounds, and they've walked it back upfield. It will be just a 12-yard punt.
No pressure, really the worst case scenario for your special teams in that situation. Now the Florida Gators with, again, tremendous field position. The question is, can they finish a drive without a turnover? That's been the biggest problem today for this Florida Gator offense.
Four turnovers, as a matter of fact. So far in the second half, 16 plays, 39 yards of offense for a Florida team averaging 31 points per game and held to just six so far today. 5:37 to go. Taylor, they stretch him out. He'll pick up a couple. I believe that was your guy Zach Cunningham and Darian Herring getting there. Cunningham has been having a huge day for the Commodore D.
Five, six, seven guys swarming to the football. Yeah, Cunningham's getting there, but all these defenders are getting to the football. It's been a tremendous effort so far with 5 minutes left in this game. And right now, if I'm Treon Harris, if it's not there, I'm using my legs to try to spurt this offense and get some big yards down the field.
Pressure coming off the edge. Harris's pass caught. Robinson knew where the first down marker was, and he reached for it and got there. 8 yards and a first down.
You're right, he needed 8 yards, and he got 8 yards. Sometimes you see receivers come short of the sticks. Not only was he there, but he gives that extra stretch out and gets the team a big first down, covered by McGasper tightly on that play.
Remember, a field goal can win it, but can the Gators rely on their kicking game as they inch closer again to the red zone, where they have turned it over twice and been stopped on a fourth down inside the 5-yard line today? Harris underneath Robinson. Nice move to get to the outside. And a 9-yard pickup.
Crossing route worked phenomenal earlier in this football game. Now they get it back to the same man, number 11, Robinson. And he makes some people miss and gets a big play.
Andrew Williamson is the player that appeared to be cramping up on the sideline for Vanderbilt. They're starting safety.
Hot weather down here, not used to playing in these kind of conditions. I do believe they invented a drink down here at this school.
Mm-hmm. They sure did.
Which is everywhere on the sidelines. And again, Derek Mason, this is about as feisty as I've seen him for an entire game. I mean, number one, he's got an opportunity here for a huge, huge win against the Gators. And two, he's coaching and he's headsets and a lot of things going on right now that he's not happy about with the referees.
In his second season, did not win a game in the SEC last year, and now this season they've got one. They beat Missouri, held them to 3 points, and now trying to knock off 10th ranked Florida, holding the Gators thus far to just six with Florida on the move. Taylor. Good job. I believe that was that McGaster roaring up from the secondary to force him back to the middle where Wynn gobbled him up. Third down and perhaps two downs to use for the Gators.
And as you're running that outside zone to the left, there's no push up the field. The Vanderbilt defense line continues to just press and hold the line of scrimmage, and there's no holes for this offense to get through.
Right now, they're looking at a 44-yard field goal attempt. If they cannot pick up the first down, they'll go two tight ends. Pressure coming from Vanderbilt. Taylor to the 25, and he appears to be shy. Paul, what's the kicking situation for the Gators?
Oh, boy. Coach Mack just informed his special teams coordinator, get Harden ready. Austin Harden, the junior, has not kicked all day. We saw Neil McInnes, who responded to an open tryout, the dentist major. He missed that first extra point. Now they're going with Harden. This kid is ice cold. He's warmed up only about three kicks, Beth.
Harden is 3 for 7 on the season, Paul. His long is a 37-yarder against East Carolina in their second game of the season. This would be a 43-yard field goal to give 10th-ranked Florida the lead. And a timeout called.
Timeout, Florida. They're second.
Vanderbilt wants to ice him up. Oh, check that. Timeout called by Florida. Perhaps they're going to talk a little bit about this. They've got one left. Down one. Austin Harden, the junior from Atlanta, was the starter early in the season, lost it, an injury forced the Gators to have an open call for another kicker. But in this situation, they will go back to Harden. 43 yards for the lead, and it is good! This is the new money down for Florida. Fourth down for Austin Harden. And a huge sigh of relief as the Gators go up 9-7, 2:22 to go. And Vanderbilt, all right, now they know they've got some time. They've got a couple of timeouts. And they've got a kicker that's a little more reliable, and Tommy Openshaw has hit from 49 yards this year.
In all due respect to McInnes, the new kicker, you cannot put that young man in that situation. I thought McElwain made the right call. Listen, Harden, he's had his ups and downs, but he's been the kicker all year. He's the one that's taken the reps. Young man steps up and makes a big kick for this football team. A much dire needed points for them to take the lead. Tremendous effort by them. Now, the Vandy offense, which has been down and out this entire game. What will they bring to the table? That's the question.
Huge opportunity right here for the Vandy special teams to get them a shorter field. Absent a passing game the entire afternoon for the Commodores, and they will bring it out. And they will not get past the 15-yard line. Long field against one of the nation's top defenses now with 2:15 to go. Well, tonight after Arizona and USC, make sure to stick around for SportsCenter at night. Catch all the highlights and reacts from a busy day in college football, the NBA, the NHL. It's SportsCenter at night, kicking off after the Pac-12 action on ESPN, also on Watch ESPN. What a moment. It's been a rocky ride for Austin Harden this year. And right now his 43-yarder stands as the game winner.
Okay.
And it may be what gets Florida into the SEC championship game.
Johnny McCrary's only completed two passes the entire game. Can he come up big for this Vanderbilt offense?
McCreary will keep, and he's stuffed by Caleb Brantley. It's a Gator defense ranked top 15 in the nation in total defense, scoring defense. Not going to be easy.
57 Brantley, 90 Bullard, 14 McAllister. All these players on this defense have stood up to the challenge and dominated this Vanderbilt offense, waiting for their offense on the other side to make something happen with the big kick. Now they get a chance to live it up.
McCreary to the air, incomplete. The wide receiver had to turn into defensive back so that one wouldn't get intercepted. It was Chris Quintero trying to make sure that Brian Poole didn't pick it, and it's third and 10.
Tightly contested coverage, and again, their top receiver, number 10, Trent Sherfield, has not played this entire half. You're going to second, third tier receivers who have not been in the situation to make huge plays for your offense.
The throw down the middle, incomplete, intended for Caleb Scott, and it is fourth down with a minute and a half to go.
A lot to ask from these Vanderbilt receivers to go out there and make some plays when they had not touched the ball the entire day. Again, your best weapons if you're Vanderbilt, seven Webb, six Sims, maybe try to get them involved or split them out, but right now the coverage is tight by a superior secondary of Florida. And the linebackers are playing in the middle of the field, just waiting and reading the eyes of McCreary. Fourth down here and long for this Vanderbilt offense.
Edge pressure coming, McAllister giving chase. The throw downfield, incomplete. And there is a flag on the play. Wilson broke up the pass intended for Scott.
Might get a pass interference here on the defense, which would move the chains and give Vanderbilt new life.
Holding defense, a 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
And a fresh set of downs for Vanderbilt. They're not done yet.
Hard to see there where the hold was. A contested throw, I believe it was earlier, at the top of the screen on the crossing route. Slot receiver on the top, getting grabbed right there. There he is, getting grabbed, held right there. Referees are going to call that.
Pass incomplete, should have been caught by Stephen Choi. Second down.
Stephen Choi's been a sure-handed tight end for this team. Senior, 34th start of his career. Second leading receiver on the team. Hasn't gotten any action either. I mean, these are players that have not gotten any chance to catch footballs today in this football game. You got this swamp rocking right now. The fans are getting crazy. The defense is getting jacked up. One-on-one coverage on the outside. Somebody's got to win in this situation.
McCreary, down he goes. Slammed by Jordan Sherritt. And there's a flag down as well in the backfield. Fifth sack for Florida.
Be interesting. Pointing towards the Gators here.
Personal foul targeting number 17 of the defense. That play is under review.
And that was Jordan Sherritt who sacked the quarterback.
Well, here's the situation. He's coming off the edge right here. And again, Got to take your target down. I was thinking maybe McCrary was falling down towards the ground and protecting himself. But in actuality, Sherrick takes him a little high and does hit him helmet to helmet. Although it doesn't look like it touches him. It hits him hard in his chest. You get a little whiplash there. Let's watch it right here.
The Gators, Jordan Cronkright, a targeting ejection last week in the Georgia game. And now it's Jordan Sherritt. They are taking a look. An official review on the targeting foul.
And this is going to come down to the referee's judgment. Was that intentional? Or was it because of a situation where the quarterback's kind of coming down? It's a huge call. I mean, you're talking about new downs, 15 yards, and you take a player in 17.
After review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. Number 17 is disqualified for targeting. It's a 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. It will be a first down. Number 2 is able to stay in the game due to a foul with his helmet coming off.
So Sherritt will leave the field. 2 first downs on this drive for Vanderbilt, both Florida penalties.
And they've been in position to make the plays to end both of those with a contested pass, a holding call away from the pass, which wouldn't have done anything in that play. And then this opportunity where Sherritt has a clear hit on the quarterback, just needs to lower his target a little bit. But again, very close there on the review.
...25 yards from the 2 penalties for Vanderbilt here to get them out to their own 38. 1:10 to go. They've got 2 timeouts. Pressure again. Incomplete on the throw to Scott. It was Antonio Morrison getting after McCrary. 2nd down.
Yeah, they got press coverage across the board. They're bringing pressure on the outside. What they're going to do is they're forcing McCrary to make a decision now. What happens in this situation is one of your receivers has to win one-on-one. And to me, I take the wide side of the field. And unfortunately, that's going to be one against one of their better DBs, number 6, Quincy Wilson. So, again, they're going to have to make a play down the field in this situation, see if they take a chance against that coverage.
McAllister getting around the corner, and he gets to the quarterback. And will Vandy call a timeout? Under a minute to go. Clock continues to move. And now they've called it. And the officials may need to see about whether or not they need to put time on the clock. But let's go back to the sack.
Freakish speed on the outside. Look at him dip. Folks, he's 6'6". Get that body dipped underneath. Get your body dipped underneath that low. That's tremendous right there. That's some freakish athletic ability, tremendous body control, and a huge play that this Gator defense desperately needed. Wow.
He's had a couple of those coming around the edge. Check out the clock down there on our scoreboard. It's back up to 52 seconds is when Vanderbilt called the timeout. They've got 1 left. And a quarterback who is just 2 for 12, 9 total passing yards today. Stepping up, running for his life, still not out of trouble. Somehow got the pass away out of the grasp of Caleb Brantley. And it's 4th down.
Just relentless pursuit right now by the defensive line. First it was McAllister on the play before in the sack. Now 57, Caleb Brantley. Sophomore, and I told you early in this game, he's taking games over. They need one more stop right now.
Fourth down and movement, and I believe the flag will be against Vanderbilt. They have been saved twice on this drive by penalties against Florida.
False start. Offense, number 53, the 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
And it's back to fourth down. Seconds if the Gators get a stop. Moments away from a trip to Atlanta for the SEC championship game. McCrary throws downfield. It's caught, but it is short of the marker. And the Florida defense gets the stop. And possession of the football with 36 seconds to play. And the Commodores with one timeout to stop the clock. That's it.
Yeah, the pressure has been phenomenal. Keep everything in front of you if you're a defensive back. Make the tackle on the point where the ball is caught. Comes up short. And that man right there, he's relieved. He's happy. And he's feeling it. Right there, he knows. And I'll tell you, what a day. Four turnovers for this offense. The Florida Gators defense has stepped up.
It's been 15 years since the home crowd has had a chance to celebrate an SEC Eastern Division title. And it will end a 6-year drought. A 6-year drought of trips to the SEC final. It's today's AT&T Strong performance, and it is the boot of Austin Harden, the 43-yard field goal, which stands as the game winner.
Well, Beth, nobody gave this team a chance preseason. People picked them fifth, fourth in the SEC East. Jim McElwain has made a tremendous turnaround in a season where people thought this would be a rebuilding year to get this team to fight, to believe, and early in November, they found themselves with a Southeastern crown. Tremendous season, players and coaches.
And it will continue at 8-1, still very much in the chase for a playoff spot as well, with games remaining against South Carolina, Florida Atlantic, Florida State. And now for Gator Nation, you can put it on the calendar, a trip to Atlanta on December 5th. The congratulations, McElwain and Mason, two of the newcomers to the SEC. It wasn't always pretty for the offenses. The defenses rule the day. Paul now with Jim McElwain.
Coach, that last drive was extended with a couple of personal fouls. What gave you the confidence that your defense could stop them?
Our defense has been playing great all year. And you know what? It's a great win for all the Gators out there. It wasn't pretty by any stretch of imagination. I feel horrible for Derek. They played their tails off. But you know what? It's about finding a way to win, and we did.
Why'd you go to Austin Harden with that last kick? He hadn't kicked all game.
Well, he's our kickoff guy, number one. But number two, he's our long field goal guy. So anything inside the 20 was going to be the dentist, and anything outside was going to be him. So,
Coach, you took over this job. This is year one. You were preseason fifth in the SEC. What made you believe this moment was possible, winning an SEC East?
Well, these guys, first of all, man, they've invested a ton. They believe in each other. And, you know, at the end of the day, no matter what you do in life, you don't go expect to lose. So that's kind of where we're at.
Congratulations.
Thanks.
Florida Gators, your SEC Eastern Division champions, and on to the SEC championship game. Still plenty of football to play in the regular season. Still in the championship chase, thanks to the kicker